Yes, good.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Okubo-san, are you ready?
Okay, I'm ready.
Yes. So let's get started. So the second talk in the morning session is given by Tsuyoshi Okubo. And he's now going to tell us about Tensor Network study of honeycomb lattice key-type model. So please.
Thank you very much for your kind introduction. I'm Tsuyoshi Okubo from the University of Tokyo. Today, I will talk about application of the tensor network method that is inspired by the quantum information to the condensed matter physics. And especially, I talk about the recent progress on the physics of the key-type model on the honeycomb lattice. And they are the main collaborator of this talk, this work. Okay. Then this is the content of my talk. First, I briefly introduce the what is the tensor network. And then I also introduce the basics of the honeycomb lattice key-type model. Then today I focus on the application of tensor network method to the gapless key-type spin leakage state in the honeycomb lattice key-type model. And if I have enough time, I also talk about extension of the tensor network method to the finite temperature simulation. This work is ongoing, and so it is not so sophisticated, but I think it is also interesting. Okay, let's move on to the introduction. So I'm coming from the field of condensed matter physics, and in our field, there are a variety of phenomena, such as the chemical reaction, superconductivity, topological state, and so on. And most of them are related to the interaction of the quantum particles. And so that we need to solve the quantum manipulation problem to understand this phenomena. And as you know, in order to understand, investigate the quantum many problems, what we need to solve is to solve the Schrödinger equation like this. And by using the proper basis, that we can consider this Schrödinger equation as a linear algebra and to solve the eigenvalue problem. And the point is that, as you know, that as increase the number of particles, the dimension of the vector space increases exponentially. And so that we can say that the quantum many problem is identical to the eigenvalue problem of the huge matrices. And because the dimension is dimension increases exponentially, to solve this problem numerically by classical computer, we need huge memory and huge computation time. And so because of this, the numerical approaches for the quantum many body systems, especially for the quantum spin systems, that are limited. For example, if we wanted to directly solve the eigenvalue problem by using a diagonalized Hamiltonian matrix, but even if we use the state of the art supercomputer, now we can only solve the 50 up to 50 site spin one half spin models. But on the other hand, in order to understand the phenomena, we need to consider the so-called thermodynamic limit. And so we need to carefully extrapolate these results. And the other direction is quantum Monte Carlo technique. And by using this technique within statistical error, we can solve the problem exactly. But as we learned from yesterday's talk, there is a sign problem for the interesting phenomena. And so in many cases, we cannot apply this quantum Monte Carlo technique. And the third technique is the variational method. So in this method, we assume the shape of the wave function and that wave vector. And the tensor network method is one of this variational method. The tensor network method is inspired by the quantum information, and we design the wave function so that it satisfies the area of the entanglement entropy for many cases. And by using that property, we can say that we can apply this tensor network method to the very large system size and even infinite, as I will explain later. Okay, so this is a schematic view of the information compression by using the tensor network. And as I explained, we cannot treat the entire data in the present computers. And so in order to solve the quantum many problem efficiently, we try to reduce the effective dimension of the Hilbert space. And actually, by considering the proper subspace of the Hilbert space, we can represent the quantum state efficiently. Here, efficiently means that we don't need the exponentially large memory. And one of the such proper subspace is the tensor network quantum state. Okay, then this is a brief review of the tensor network state. Suppose we have a great, for example, ground state wave function, and we expand this wave function in the some basis. Typically, it is the spin up and down. Then we consider this vector as the n-leg tensor. Then we decompose this tensor into the product of the lot of small tensors. The most famous example is so-called the matrix product state. That is represent this n-leg tensor as a product of matrices like this. But we can generalize this matrix product state to the more general tensor network like this. And by using such kind of the generalized network, if we can choose the good network, we can express the ground state wave function very efficiently. the if we consider the case of the matrix product state, the, as I explained, the original vector or tensor has the exponentially large independent element, but if we can accurately approximate this n-length tensor by the matrix product state, in that case, the independent element is linear of the system size n. Number of the matrices in this case. And so we can obtain the very huge data reduction. And so we can perform the simulation of the quantum many-body system in the classical computer by using the, for example, matrix product state. But here we assume that the size of the matrix to approximate the original tensor is independent of the system size n here. And if this assumption is correct, we can say that the even if we increase the system size, the number of independent element is only linearly increased, not exponential. But how the matrix size depends on the system size is related to the network structure. And in order to understand how to design the tensor network is related to the area of the entanglement entropy. As you know, the entanglement entropy is defined as a von Neumann entropy of the reduced density matrix. For example, if we divide the system into two parts like this, and if we consider the general wave function in our Hilbert space, the entanglement entropy is known to proportional to the volume of the subsystem A, for example. And it is clear if we consider a random vector, for example. However, if we are only interested in the low energy physics, for example, the ground state, that it is known that the, a lot of the ground states, such in the a lot of ground states, this entanglement entropy is only proportional to its area, not the volume. And it is called as the area law. And it means that if we are only interested in the low energy physics, we can use this property and we can use this property to design the tensor network. And here we focus on the so-called tensor product state or the PEPS. And that is the tensor network to represent the d-dimensional quantum many-body systems. And by using the tensor network diagram, it looks like this. So here we consider that square lattice quantum many-body systems. And in that case, we design the tensor network like the square lattice here. And in our language, there is a special parameter D that determines the dimension of the virtual legs connecting the each tensors, like this. And it is called as the bond dimension. And later we will use this tensor product state as a variation on that for our quantum many-body system. And in that case, this D determines the accuracy of the, our variation wave function. Okay, before going to the main discussion, let's check the this PEPS, this tensor product state satisfy the area of the entanglement entropy. So this is the schematic view of the our tensor network on the our system. And let's consider the entanglement entropy between the region A and region B, like this. And here I set the length of this subsystem A is equal to L, like this. And we can easily show that the rank of the reduced density matrix A is bounded by the number of degrees of freedom connecting the region A and the region B. And in the case of the tensor product state, we can say that we can easily calculate that it is proportional to number of bond is proportional to the area of the subsystem A and B. And because of this, that we can say that the number of degree of freedom is d to the, this nc. And we can say that from this inequality, the entanglement entropy is bounded by this term. It means that at least the upper bound satisfy the area of the entanglement entropy. So it means that the tensor product state under can satisfy the area rule for the any dimension d. And it means that we can efficiently approximate vectors in higher dimensional space by tensor product state. There is no rigorous proof, but this fact indicates that the tensor product state could approximate infinite system with a finite d. And so later I will discuss the simulation based on the infinitely large tensor network state. And so the property of the infinite size by using the classical computer simulation. Okay, so this is the one example of the exactly represented by the tensor product state. That this is the probably all of you know the what is the toric code model. And it is known that the ground state of this toric code model is represented by the d equal to tensor product state by using this representation. And the point is that the ground state of the toric code model is so-called the Dedekind spin liquid state. And in the sense of the condensed matter physics, that this spin liquid state is kind of exotic state, different from the magnetically ordered state. Such kind of the interesting state, we can represent that ground state wave function by using only d equal to tensor product state. We can represent that state the very compact way by using a tensor product state. And by using this tensor product state, we can perform the variational calculation. And this is just a summary of the numerical method to obtain the variational calculation using the tensor product state. But here, I assume that we consider the infinitely large tensor product state. And so the these are the cost to obtain the infinite size simulation. Okay, anyway, usually we use the imagined time evolution to optimize our tensor network. And also we need to evaluate the tensor network. And in that case, the so-called corner transfer matrix method often used to construct the tensor network. These are not so important, but I have one comment. So typically the computation cost is scaled as d to the tenth or something like that. And so even if we reduce the computation cost to from the exponential to the polynomial, that its power is very large. And so it is the difficulty in the present numerical simulation. Okay, so here I show you the example of the application of such kind of the quantum tensor product state. And here the left-hand side is the application of the tensor product state calculation for the magnetization of the honeycomb Kagome lattice Heisenberg model. And the right hand side is the similar magnetization curve for the Frobenius square lattice model. And especially this calculation is based on the collaboration with the experimental people. And so nowadays the tensor product state method is very useful to investigate the realistic experiment. Okay, at the end of this introduction, I'd like to comment about the different method, the different tensor network method. There is a different tensor network method, so-called the tensor network realization, and that is approximately construct the tensor network by using the coarse graining of the network structure. And we can also use this kind of the technique to investigate a quantum many body system to the past integral formulation like this. And it is also deeply related to the tensor network state today I introduced. And in that sense, this tensor network renormalization is also the very important technique in the tensor network, but today I didn't talk about this topic. However, I have been contributed to this TLG technique by developing the new algorithm recently. And so if you are interested in these techniques, please see these papers. This is just an advertisement. Okay. So anyway, today I only talk about the tensor network state representation. Okay, so this is just an introduction. So if you don't have any questions, I'd like to move on to the introduction of the honeycomb lattice key type model. That is the main target of today's topic. Okay, then I will introduce the model. That today we consider the honeycomb lattice key type model that is defined on the two-dimensional honeycomb lattice like this. And the point is that the interaction is Ising-like, but the interaction component is depend on the direction of the bond. And it is known that this model is exactly solvable by introducing the Majorana fermion picture like this. Then the one important property of this honeycomb lattice key-type model is the existence of the conserved quantity, so-called the flux. When we define the operator, six body operator like this on this bracket on the honeycomb lattice, and it is commute with the Hamiltonian itself, and so it is a conserved quantity, and also the this flux operator defined on the different bracket is also commutable. And so there are many conserved quantity in this system. And it has been shown that the ground state is in the sector with the all bracket flux operator of the all bracket is equal to one. Sorry, I didn't mention that the eigenvalue of this flux operator is plus minus one. I'm sorry. And so the ground state is located in this sector, and it is called as the vortex-free condition. Okay, then we can draw the phase diagram exactly. And this honeycomb lattice type model, we have two types of the spin liquid state, as shown in this phase diagram. And if the coupling is anisotropic, so in these regions, the spin liquid state is the gapped spin liquid. And in this case, the excitation of the Majorana fermion has the finite gap. And it is known that it adiabatically connected to the toric cold state I introduced before. And so it means in some sense that it is understood well. On the other hand, if the interaction strength is almost isotropic, the spin liquid state changes to the so-called gapless spin liquid state. And in this case, the Majorana fermion shows a gapless excitation, although the flux excitation is gapped. And today I'd like to focus on this gapless spin liquid state. And before going to the main result, I'd like to mention about that we can calculate the ground state of the Steiff model easily if the ground state is not a spin liquid state. That in the real compound, that we may have the Steiff-like coupling if there is a strong spin orbit interaction. And such kind of the material is called as the Steiff material. And actually, one compound, sodium to iridium O3, is one of the such kind of active material. Then, from the ab initio calculation, we can obtain the spin Hamiltonian. And that contains the active interaction plus a lot of the complicated interaction. And we can apply the tensor product state method to draw the phase diagram of this spin Hamiltonian. And we can draw the phase diagram, something like that. And the sodium iridate, sodium to iridium O3, is located here in this phase diagram. Horizontal axis is the one parameter, so called the trigonal distortion. Then this phase diagram shows the ground state is zigzag Z state. It is consistent with the experiment. It means that, and also the point is that the ground state is not a spin liquid state because of these additional interactions. And in this case, the infinite tensor product state calculation correctly captures such magnetically ordered ground state. Okay, this is one example, successful example, but if we are interested in the spin liquid state, there are several problems. The one problem is that by using the tensor product state as a variation of wave function, and by using the standard optimization technique, so-called imaginary time evolution, we obtain the biased result depending on the initial state. And probably the left-hand figure is important. The horizontal axis is a 1 over D. D is a Bode dimension. And the vertical axis is a magnetization. And we can treat only the finite Bode dimension to approximate the spin liquid state. And in that case, we have the finite magnetization. It means that finite D tensor product state, in this case, is not the spin liquid state because we have the finite magnetization. And it means that it is very important to find a good initial state for the active spin liquid state or a better optimization scheme to investigate the spin liquid state. And today, I talk about the first approach. So how to prepare the good initial state of the active spin liquid state. And in order to understand obtain the good tensor network representation of the spin liquid state, there have been several trials. In the case of the gap spin liquid state of the active spin liquid, as I mentioned before, that state is adiabatically connected to the toric chord state. And as I mentioned before, the toric chord state is exactly represented by the D equal to infinite tensor product state. So we can say that in this case, we know the compact tensor network representation. But in the case of gapless spin liquid state, although we know the exact wave function, but it is not, there is no simple tensor network representation so far. So because we know how to construct the wave function, we can exactly mimic such procedure by the tensor network language. But in that case, we obtain this kind of a very complicated tensor network diagram. And it is exact, but not so simple. And the natural question is, can we construct a simpler tensor network state for the gapless active spin liquid? Today, I'd like to answer this question. Okay. Then, if there is no question, I'd like to move on to the main result. Do you have any questions so far? Okay. Okay, then if not, let's move on to the main result. So today, I'd like to consider how to construct the simple tensor network state to represent the gapless Kitaifu-speaking state. And the one important property is the vortex-free sector, vortex-free condition. As I introduced in the previous section, the Kitaifu-spin liquid state is in the vortex-free sector. And so the first trial is to project our wave function to such sector. And so in order to project out the our wave function into the such sector, let us consider the projector onto this sector. And before going to the vortex free sector, first, let's consider the projector on the WI equal one sector. So the projector on the only the sector, only the one bracket is vortex free. And clearly, that is represented as like this. So because the eigenvalue of this, operator is plus minus one, then we can easily check that this projector can be represented by D equal to tensor network like this, and whose element is represented by this. So here I correspond to this part, and the sigma is a Pauli matrices, and it corresponds to this one. I think it is not so difficult. Then based on this representation, how to construct the vortex-free sector. The mathematically, the projector is written like this. And so, but the problem is that how to obtain the compact representation of this projector. But what we obtained is that this projector is given by the loop gas operator defined like this. And so we can represent again that this projector by using only the D equal to tensor product state. In this case, we consider operator. And so this is tensor product operator instead of the tensor product state. This loop gas operator is almost zero instead of these three or four cases. So because this is D equal to tensor product operator, each indices has the zero or one index, then this operator is non-zero when the two of three virtual legs is identical. And the combination is 0, 0, 0 or 0, 1, 1 or 1, 1, 0 or something like that. And depending on the combination of the 1, 1, the different Pauli matrices correspond to this value of the operator. Then by using this operator, we can easily confirm that the product of this tensor network consists of this loop gas operator is graphically represented by this. And tensor network represents the sum over the all closed loop. If we draw this 1, 1 line as red thick lines like this. And if we realize that the product of two nearest neighbor, flux operator is represented by the one, closed loop, we can easily confirm that this diagram is correspond to the product of the projector. And so this loop gas operator clearly represent the projector onto the vortex-free sector. And then next we construct the tensor network state, probably corresponding to the Kitaifu-spin liquid state. And that state is constructed as like this. So first we prepare the ferromagnetically ordered state product state, classical product state, and where the spins pointing the 111 direction like this. Then we multiply the projector. Clearly, that state is the D equals the tensor product state. And let's see the property of this state. Because this state is based on this loop gas operator, we call this state as a loop gas state. Okay, this is the summary of the properties of the loop gas state. We can easily confirm that this state has the following symmetry. From the symmetries of the loop gas operator and the ferromagnetically ordered state, the loop gas state is symmetric under the lattice translation and the C6 lattice rotation plus speed rotation and reflection plus time reversal. And also we can confirm that the vortex free condition itself ensures that the loop gas state is non-magnetic. So it means that if we calculate the expectation value of the magnetization, it is exactly equal to zero. And these properties are qualitatively very similar to the Kitaev spin bucket. In addition to these symmetries, that we can also consider the criticality of the loop gas state. It is known that the criticality of the gapless spinning state is belong to the so-called conformal quantum critical point. And in this case, the wave function itself shows the criticality in two dimensions. And this criticality belongs to the C equal 1/2 eigenuniversality class. And it means that if a wave function phi is adiabatically connected to the gapless Kitaev spinning state, the null of this wave function should show the critical behavior which belongs to the eigenuniversality class. And we can exactly show that the loop gas state is the classical loop gas model like this. And the norm of the loop gas state is equal to the partition function of some classical loop gas model like this. Okay, and in the case of the honeycomb lattice model, this kind of the loop gas classical loop gas model is exactly solvable, and actually this 1/√3 is the critical point of this honeycomb lattice loop gas model, and also its universality is eigen. And so our loop gas state satisfy the criticality same with the gapless Kitaev spin liquid state. And so far we checked that the qualitative property of the loop gas state is in common with the property of the gapless Kitaev spin liquid state, that it satisfies the symmetries and the non-magnetic, and the criticality is also same with the Kitaev spin liquid state. And we would say that one can consider loop gas state as the simplest example of the gapless Kitaev spin liquid state. Okay. So far, I only mentioned about the qualitative property of the loop gas state, but how it is close? Is it close to the ground state of the Kitaev model? When we calculate the energy of the loop gas state, it is unfortunately, it is far from the exact ground state energy. And so if we consider the loop gas state as a variational state of the ground state of the Kitaifu model, it is not so good. Quantitatively, it is not so good. However, we can systematically improve this energy expectation value by considering the family of the loop gas state by using a tensor network. And I will skip the details of this construction, but we can consider the similar operator, so-called the Dymer gas operator. And by multiplying this operator to our loop gas state, we can systematically construct the improved tensor network state. And it depends on the how many loop gas operator, Dymer gas operator applied to the loop gas state. And each Dymer gas operator contains a one variational parameter. And so if we multiply the two Dymer gas operator to the loop gas state, it contains the only two variational parameters, something like that. And this is the energy expectation value obtained by this construction. And we can see that after we multiply the two loop gas operator, Dymer gas operators to the loop gas state, we obtain this energy expectation value. It is only different from the 0.7% from the exact energy. And we can obtain this variational state by using only two variational parameters. And it is also support that this loop gas state is very similar to the gapless Kitaifu spin leakage state. And so now we obtained this loop gas state, tensor network state, which is very similar to the gapless Kitaifu spin leakage state. And so we can use this spin leakage state as for example, initial state of the variational calculation for the more complicated and non-exactly solvable models. Okay, and we can, so this is just an advertisement, and we can extend this kind of the construction to the different lattice, Kitaifu model on the different lattice. And for example, if we consider star lattice, it is known that its ground state is the chiral spin leakage state, and depending on the ratio between the different bonds, there is a phase transition between the non-abelian chiral spin leakage phase to the abelian chiral spin leakage phase. And by using our construction, we can clearly capture this kind of the phase transition. And in this sense, our loop gas state construction is, very general for the Kitaifu model on the, general lattices. And as I mentioned before, that we can use loop gas state as an initial state. And for example, in the previous example, I mentioned that if we draw the phase diagram corresponding to the sodium ionizate, and if we can expand the lattice constant of this compound, we can show that in some region, actually the Kitaifu spin leakage state is appear. Kitaifu spin leakage state appear. And this calculation has been done by using the loop gas state as an initial condition. And so the loop gas state is very useful to the realistic calculation. Okay, and so far I consider the ground state of the honeycomb lattice Kitaifu model. And finally, I'd like to mention about the finite temperature property of how to investigate the finite temperature property of the quantum medieval systems by the tensor network. This is an ongoing project. And so the results are not so sophisticated, but I'd like to share our recent progress. Okay, so basically, in order to calculate the finite temperature property, we need to calculate the expectation value based on the density matrix like this. And in the numerics, we can choose the several techniques. The first one is the just direct, directly diagonalize the Hamiltonian, as in the case of the, for example, ground state calculation. But you can easily imagine that the it is very difficult because the dimension of the Hilbert space increases exponentially as before. And we can also use the QMC, but as in the case of the ground state calculation, the it can be applicable only for the limited system. There is no sign problem. And another approach is the typical pure state. So that this is based on the fact that the almost all physical property at the finite temperature is represented by a special pure state, and to try to find the such typical pure state. And the sorry, the other the final approach is the the direct extension of the tensor network state to the density operator. And I'd like to mention about this approach. That in order to represent the density matrix by the tensor network, there are two kinds of the approaches. The first one is that we represent the density matrix itself by the tensor as a tensor product state, like this. In the case of the one dimension, we represent this density matrix as like this. The merit is the algorithm becomes very simpler, but the demerit is like the approximated density matrix may contain the negative or complex eigenvalue because the this structure does not ensure the positivity of the density matrix. The different approach is the so-called the local purification. And here we assume that the purified density matrix, and we try to approximate the this state purified state by using the tensor network state. And in this case, the density matrix is by construction positive semi-definite. However, it is known that the bond dimension can be much larger than the this direct application. And so in practice, the this kind of the construction is not so efficient. And so today I will focus on this first approach. And again, we try to apply this technique to the honeycomb lattice Kitaev model. And in the pure Kitaev model, we can apply the quantum Monte Carlo technique to investigate the finite temperature property. And the most interesting property is that the specific heat shows the two double peak structure like this. And the second peak, lower temperature peak, is related to the development of the flux as decrease the temperature. And let's apply the tensor network method to the disk type model, final temperature type model. Okay, before going to the result, there is another motivation. So as I mentioned before, that we have several Kitaev materials, and one of the Kitaev material is the ruthenium trichloride. And in the experiment done in the Kyoto University, they showed that at a finite temperature and at a finite magnetic field, they observe the so-called thermal hole conductivity, and that is quantized in some unit, half quantized in some unit. And if we can calculate that this kind of thermal hole conductivity by numerics, we can confirm this kind of the behavior in the realistic simulation. Okay, then let's see what is the performance of the tensor network calculation for the finite temperature property. And please see the left-hand figure. It shows the specific heat as a function of the temperature for different curve correspond to the different bond dimensions. And you can see that for smaller bond dimension, we don't see the second peak here, but as increase the bond dimension, we see the second peak. And so it means that at least qualitatively, we can reproduce the double peak structure of the specific heat. However, if we compare this result with the QMC, seriously, we realize that the second peak is not quantitatively reproduced. The height, peak height of the second peak is smaller than the quantum Monte Carlo simulation. So it means that in the present status, this ITPO approach is insufficient to investigate the lower temperature property. Although the higher temperature region is very good. And I think this is probably due to the difficulty to optimize the infinite tensor product state. And so now I consider the finite size system, and because the optimization becomes easier. And this is one example, this is the final slide, actually. And here we consider the finite size cylinder instead of the infinite three-dimensional system. And for this setup, we can use the matrix product operator representation of the density matrix. And it is known that it works very well for this cylinder. And in this case, we can accurately calculate the specific heat under the magnetic field like this. Here, we have several curves. It corresponds to the different magnetic fields like this. So because this calculation is motivated by the previous thermal hole conductivity, so here we apply the magnetic field, external magnetic field. And here we show that clearly we have the two peak structure under the magnetic field. And also the peak height is enough large comparable with the first peak. In the previous infinite system size case, the second peak height is smaller than the first peak. But in this case, we have the enough large peak. It means that we quantitatively reproduce the double peak structure in the case of the finite size cluster. And we performed these kind of the simulation for the different model, including the different interactions. And we can discuss the interesting property, such as the thermal conductivity at the finite temperature. And I will repost this thermal hole conductivity in the next JPS meeting. And so if you join the JPS meeting, and if you are interested in this topic, please come to my talk. Okay, let me summarize my talk. Today, I show you that tensor networks are very useful to investigate the quantum many-body problems. And I showed several examples that we can investigate a variety of fluxless spin systems by using the infinite tensor product state. And at the main part, I show that we can construct a compact tensor network representation for the gapless kinetic spinning state. And it has a lot of property in common with the exact gapless kinetic spinning state. And I also show that we can extend the tensor network approach to a finite temperature system. And unfortunately, for the infinite kinetic model, the quantitatively the accuracy is not so enough, sufficient for the low temperature region. But for finite size cluster, we can obtain the reliable result by using the matrix product operator representation. Okay, that's all. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for nice talk, including some partial review of tensor network approaches. So Is there any question or comment? Takayanagi-san, please.
Thank you very much for this really wonderful and many developments of this tensor network. I have a question about finite temperature calculations. I'm not familiar with this kind of formulation, this finite temperature. Okay. So I use this low beta is kind of, you are treating this as a kind of path integral from with interval beta, and this is somehow discretizing.
Yes. Okay, yes. So here, rho beta is just like this. And we try to represent this operator by yes, the tensor network.
I see. And in the whole ground state or just zero temperature case, we can minimize energy to optimize tensors. Mm-hmm. So for finite temperature case, but how do you choose optimize tensors?
Okay, it's a very good question. So I didn't mention how to optimize this one, but one typical approach is just starting from the infinite temperature limit and apply the imaginary time evolution. And I used in my calculation, but we can use a different formulation by using the, how to say, variational principle of the free energy. Uh-huh. And if we construct our tensor network by using the projector only, in that case, we can say that our tensor network satisfied some variational principle related to the free energy. And so we can variationally optimize the such kind of the tensor network. But in that case, tensor network structure is limited.
I see. And so you like this picture is just one layer. So are you using really one layer for this calculation?
Okay. So
actually more complicated. I just wanted
For the given beta.
Yes.
We have only one layer. But in order to apply the imaginary time evolution, we calculate this kind of the diagram, for example, by using the Suzuki-Torota decomposition.
Uh-huh.
Something like this.
What do you mean by imaginary time evolution? I thought low exponential beta is included in low beta, so it looks like imaginary time evolution.
Okay. So here I mean that suppose we have, for example, rho zero, and rho beta is defined as like this, minus two beta h. Maybe not correct. And so apply this operator for this side, for example, and this operator to this side. And if beta is enough small, we can use the Suzuki-Torota decomposition, something like
that. I see. And row zero is just this one layer. You are right.
Yeah, yes.
I see. Thank you very much. I have one more question. But you also present results for topological entropy.
In the case of this
So how do you calculate this entropy from tensor network? Are you using kind of replicatory or are you just directly evaluating from Neumann entropy itself?
So in this case, first we construct the minimally entangled state from this loop gas state construction. And we explicitly construct a cylinder formed by our tensor, local tensor. And then, if I remember correctly, we just calculate the entanglement entropy by definition. So we have the cylinder, and we divide the system into two parts, like this.
Directly evaluate this.
Yeah.
Row itself.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so is there any other question? Well, so I have one question about the finite temperature computation, the last part. Yeah, so you mentioned that you performed some finite size computation in this formalism.
Yes.
So in such case, do you need to perform some position dependent optimization of tensor?
Yes.
Or otherwise, so do you assume some uniformity of the tensors?
Okay, thank you for your question. So in this finite size calculation, we consider the, how to say, finite size cylinder.
Uh-huh.
And so in this case, there is no translational symmetry.
Uh-huh.
And basically we assume the position dependent tensors in this case. Yeah, and so we basically apply the, how to say, technique based on the MPS.
But do you need a much more computational cost to perform such a position dependent optimization?
Not so huge.
Is it not so serious?
I think so, but it's so because we treat the, how to say, density matrix instead of the state.
Mm-hmm.
So, and because of this, basically because of this, the computation cost is larger than the ground state calculation, but not so serious compared with the PEPs.
Yeah, I see. Thank you. So is there any other question or comment? If not, let's thank all the speakers in the morning session. So now we have a lunch break, so the